In the next part, we're going to talk about streaming music. The term streaming means to listen to music or watch a video in real time over the internet. So instead of downloading a file to your computer and watching it later, you have a constant flow of data streaming from the website to your computer or device. Think of it as kind of like a river or a creek. Okay? A river, a creek, has a continuous flow of water from a main source. It's the same thing here, but instead of water, you're streaming data. So you have to have a continuous connection to the internet in order for the streaming process to take place. What's important here is the speed and the strength of your internet connection, as well as your computer processor. These things all play a role in the quality of your streaming experience. There are lots of music streaming services out there. Apple Music, Spotify, SoundCloud, Pandora, Amazon Music, Google Music, YouTube Music, iHeartRadio, and this list grows, it seems, every day. As many of you know, I'm a real fan of CNET. CNET.com is a great resource for all things digital. So if you're thinking about purchasing a new device, or you want to read reviews on a particular service, website, or device, I would recommend CNET. So with this, we've got the best music streaming services for 2021, according to CNET. In this chart, you've got the top players: Amazon Music Unlimited, Apple Music, YouTube, Pandora, Spotify, and Tidal. As you can see in this column, they all have a monthly fee. Most include a free option as well. And that time period for the free option kind of changes based on which one you want. One thing you want to pay attention to is the maximum bit rate. Basically, the higher the number, the better quality sound that you're going to get. The clear winner in this market right now is Spotify. Right now, in 2021, they dominate the music streaming industry. So how did Spotify come to dominate the industry? Let's take a look.
The internet has changed so many aspects of media consumption, but few have had a more tumultuous relationship with these changes than the music industry.
I mean, I don't believe we're talking about streaming music if it's not for Napster and Sean, everything that they did.
CDs became the standard medium in the 1990s. At the same time, home computers were becoming more commonplace, many with disk drives built in, allowing users to take their favorite CDs and rip them onto their devices as MP3 files. This made way for peer-to-peer music sharing, or music piracy, through platforms like Napster and LimeWire.
If you look at Napster and, of course, other competitors that followed, it really disenfranchised the industry.
Apple, having had great success with iTunes and the iPod, decided to start selling music digitally on iTunes in 2003 as a way to charge into the music industry and combat music piracy.
It's not stealing anymore, it's good karma.
iTunes was the first legal attempt of saying, like, okay, what Napster is doing is piracy and it is the Wild Wild West. How can we start to look at digital downloads? Would people pay 99 cents for a song to be able to have access to it?
And it succeeded.
It was all about downloads. This was all about iTunes. iTunes was the driving force.
It in turn destroyed other music selling businesses, knocking out Tower Records and almost every other music store. This was a tough pill to swallow for the music industry as a whole.
During the 90s, the money was still flowing. The advances I would get, they would spend $1 million on the promotion of my singles. Me, like someone who doesn't even write mainstream stuff. But then the internet put a stop to that.
The industry was so used to big margins, trying to sell a CD for $20, and it only cost $1 to manufacture. So the margins were huge. And then to go from that to, okay, now full albums are $9.99 on iTunes, those margins started to deplete.
And for music lovers who wanted their music for free, radio was still a resource they cherished. Online radio company Pandora claimed some of that market when it launched in 2000. And 10 years later, it had 48 million subscribers.
I remember when everyone I know was trying to tweak their Pandora stations. I had it on my phone all the time, was like, oh, like this station becomes this, and it was cool.
But pirating was still an issue. A 2007 study concluded that $12.5 billion in total output was lost in the US annually because of music piracy. And radio was great, but users wanted to choose their music. That left the market open for a small Swedish company to make its way in.
We want music to be like water everywhere.
Spotify was founded in 2006 and made its way to the US in 2011. It started with an invite-only beta program for the free tier and quickly garnered favorable reviews. But it faced an uphill battle to the top.
It was getting the rights. It was convincing subscribers to get onto the platform. These were extremely difficult times for Spotify to make sure that they were able to nab the content, especially at that time.
One reason for the company's delayed entry into the US market was because of music rights. It's a complicated business that cost Spotify $9.8 billion between its launch and 2018.
They made a risky bet at the time. They're like, well, we know we're going to lose money, but that's what we're going to need to do if our investors support it. For music rights, given the price, given content, once we acquire that content, it's the carrot and the stick approach. In terms of subscribers would come.
Clearly the company was onto something, and that piqued the curiosity of some major brands. Now it seems every major tech player has its own music streaming platform. Apple dropped iTunes and created Apple Music. Amazon created Amazon Music. Google created Google Play Music and then YouTube Music. Jay-Z even formed his own service called Tidal, which focused on professional sound quality. But Spotify kept its spot at the top thanks to its freemium model, where users can listen for free with ads or pay for a subscription without ads.
We believe in a true free service. We believe in something where the user knows that they can go back month and month and month and month again and have access to their music.
By the end of 2019, Apple Music had 60 million paid subscribers worldwide. Amazon Music had 55 million subscribers worldwide, nearly all of which were paying subscribers. Chinese company Tencent had 39.9 million paying subscribers, while Spotify had 124 million paying subscribers.
It was about free going to premium. Conversion was key, and I think Spotify was really the one that started that.
Platforms like Apple Music are more exclusionary, forcing customers to pay after their free trial is up. Apple even tried to kill Spotify's free version back when Apple Music launched. Free just makes sense for customers, which is a major reason why Spotify is so popular today. But free isn't so great for musicians.
The ad dollars are actually less than the premium subscriptions. Well, Apple Music, Tidal, those platforms, you get your free trial, but you have to pay. So it's a hard pill to swallow when you're looking at your statement saying, dang, Apple Music, should I focus my energy on Apple Music because this is where the money is? Or do I still go with Spotify because that's where the users are?
As Spotify gained popularity, artists started to wonder why they weren't seeing the financial gains they were used to with CD sales and downloads. Taylor Swift boycotted Spotify in 2014, pulling all of her music off the service and saying she and other artists weren't being paid enough for each stream. Adele followed suit in 2015, announcing her album 25 would not be released on Spotify or Apple Music. The term windowing became popular, where artists would only release an album on a certain platform or would not stream an album at all for a certain amount of time.
So a lot of artists would window the records where it wasn't on Spotify, say for a certain period of time, but on Apple Music. Kanye West was known for this with Tidal.
Taylor Swift and Adele both released their albums on Spotify eventually, but it opened streaming services up to questions about how much they were paying their artists per stream. Spotify and Apple both don't release exactly how much they pay distributors per stream, but it has been reported that Spotify pays around 70% of the revenue made on a stream.
I mean, people listen to my music on Spotify. That makes me happy. Now, I know that people aren't getting paid for that, and that makes me sad. But I think that that's a systemic, technological, capitalistic, human issue, and you have to go back 300 years and look at how a musician was making their living for their intellectual property in 1901.
In 2019, Spotify announced it was moving its music focus to a more general audio focus to broaden its offerings and widen its global lead on competitors. It acquired the Joe Rogan Experience early in 2020 and penned exclusive podcast deals with Kim Kardashian and DC Comics. The company's stock jumped 8% at the announcement of the Joe Rogan acquisition alone.
A year ago, when I was on this show last time, I introduced the shift in our strategy from music to audio. At that time, we were a very small player in audio, but growing fast. Now we're the number one player in more than 20 markets around the world, and quickly catching up in the markets where we're not number one.
That's where Spotify is taking the future right now, and analysts believe it can ride that wave for a bit.
90% of our monetization is on the subscription side, but 10% is on the ad side, and we do think that there's real growth opportunity for us in the ad space, particularly with podcasts.
Just after these podcast deals were penned, the global pandemic started taking its toll on the economy. But Spotify was one of the few companies that weathered the storm. In fact, Spotify's stock increased 70% from the beginning of January 2020 to the end of June 2020.
They benefited from COVID because the lockdowns forced people to stop listening to radio, and they discovered Spotify while stuck at home.
Of course, yes, if you're Spotify, you'd much rather make money from the podcast acquisitions and that than having to pay 60 to 70 cents for every dollar to Universal or Sony.
But in order to stay at the top, Spotify is going to have to stay nimble and quick. Competitors like Tencent are already adding features like karaoke to their streaming music platforms.
Tencent, at least, is on that path from a gamification perspective. So I do think that that is an opportunity for Spotify to keep in mind, like, yes, it's great that you got Joe Rogan, it's great that you got Bill Simmons, but look at those opportunities as well. And even though it's a different market, I think there's a big opportunity there.
Nevertheless, Spotify is still very much a success story.
Today, they're sitting there drinking their cappuccino laughing as they, you know, see the success.
All right, let's do a deep dive into Spotify, how it works, its benefits, and some of its features.
For this Spotify demo, I thought it would be best to get on my iPhone to do the demo. Keep in mind, you can access Spotify from any device, your desktop computer, your laptop, your smartphone, your tablet, but you have to download the Spotify app first in order to use it. And of course, you need to sign up for an account. So as you can see, we are on my iPhone, and right down here in the lower right corner, I have my Spotify app. So I go ahead and give that a tap. And it brings me right to my home section. There's a home section, a search section, and a library section. And when you first get to Spotify, it might be a little confusing after you open your account, but basically you're going to scroll down. And again, similar to the iTunes and the Apple Music app, you can scroll through music and so on. At the very bottom, it shows me the song I currently have in progress. Of course, it's paused right now, but if I want to play it, I can just hit the play button and this song will play. I hit the down arrow and that gets me back to my main list here. So let's say I want to search for a particular artist or a particular song. I've got my search section right here, so I'm going to give that a tap. There's a search bar right here. I'll give that a tap, and when I do that, my keyboard pops up and I can type in the particular name of the artist that I want to listen to. So in this case, I'm going to type in John Denver. And there's John Denver. I give John Denver a tap. And it brings me to everything John Denver in the Spotify app. The very top, it gives me the five most popular songs on Spotify for John Denver. Take Me Home, Country Road, Annie's Song, Rocky Mountain High, and so on. But I can also scroll through all the albums called Discography. So I give that a tap, and it lists all the albums of John Denver. And I can just simply scroll till I find the album that I'm interested in. So we'll say Some Days Are Diamonds. So I give that a tap. If I want to start playing it, I simply hit my play button. And it plays the very first song on the album. If I want to pause it, I hit the pause button. And again, you can see the play button turns into a pause button after you hit play. It highlights in green the song that I'm currently listening to.
His daddy was an honest man, just a red dirt Georgia farm.
Can hit pause. If there's a particular song that I really like and I want to add it to my favorite list, there's a little heart symbol right here. And when I do that, it adds this song, San Francisco Mabel Joy, to my favorites list. My favorites list is located in my library. So if I tap on library, it lists all my various playlists. And there's a playlist right here called Liked Songs. That's where that John Denver song has now been added. What is a playlist? A playlist is a custom list of songs that you can create, and you can create titles for your playlists. I've got one here, one of my favorite playlists is called Cover Me. And what I did here was I added all the songs that I like that are covers of original songs. So if I tap on Cover Me, there's 7 hours and 3 minutes of music. And here are the various songs from different artists that have covered original songs. So one of my favorites is the Elvis Presley song, Little Sister. Well, it's covered by Dwight Yoakam. So if I want to listen to it, I give it a tap.
Little sister, don't you? Little sister, don't you?
If I want to pause it.
Little sister, don't you kiss me one.
I hit the pause button and move on. If I want to get back to my home, I could just simply tap on the home button right here. And now I'm back to my home page. Another nice feature I really like about Spotify is the suggestions that Spotify makes for me based on my listening history. So if I scroll down here, it gives me a list called Made for Dano. And Spotify has created daily mixes for me. And here's one, daily mix number 6. If I tap on it, Spotify has created this list for me, and it's based on songs that I have liked in the past, songs that I've listened to in the past. But what I really like about this daily mix option is it introduces me to songs that I've never heard before. But based on the genre, chances are I'm probably going to like the song. So, one right here is called Sweet Jane. If I tap on it, that song plays. I can swipe up here, and it brings up the album cover artwork.
Anyone has ever had a heart.
If I want to add it to my favorites, I can tap here. If I don't like it, I can just simply fast forward. To get back home, I tap on my little down button there, hit home, and I'm back to my home screen. If I want to make a playlist, let's see, let me do a search here. Let me search for an artist first. Go up here, type in who I want to search for. I'll go ahead and type in Steely Dan. There's Steely Dan. Tap on Steely Dan. And I say, okay, let's play this song right here. If I want to add it, there's these three little dots right here. I can tap on that. Here, let me pause it so you can hear me. These three little dots right here, if I tap on those three little dots, I can like the song, I can add it to a current playlist, I can share it. But in this case, I want to add it to a playlist, but I want to create a brand new playlist. So I'm going to hit Add to Playlist, New Playlist, and then I can call the playlist whatever I want. So in this case, I'm going to type in Funky Songs. I hit Create, and now I've added this song from Steely Dan into a brand new playlist called Funky Songs. If I want to add another song, I can hit my back arrow. I can go down here to search, type in another artist, Stevie Wonder. I've already put Superstition in my favorites list, but you know what? I want to add it to my brand new playlist. So I'm going to tap on those three dots, add to playlist, funky songs, and now the song has been added to that playlist. That's pretty much it. It's pretty straightforward. If I want to get out of my app, I can tap on my home button on my iPhone, and I'm back to my home screen. When I go back to Spotify, it's going to pick up where I left off. But for the most part, that's pretty much Spotify in a nutshell. Very easy to use. And the best thing about Spotify is I don't have to purchase the songs. I just pay a monthly subscription fee of $9.99, and I have access to all the music in the Spotify library. And to wrap things up, let's take a look at some of the accessories available to you. There's the traditional accessories, speakers that you can plug into your computer or into your MP3 player. This set of speakers I've got right here, those are actually the ones I currently have plugged into my desktop computer. If you want the freedom to move about without a cord, without being physically plugged into a device, there is Bluetooth wireless technology. Similar to Wi-Fi, Bluetooth is also wireless technology, meaning you don't have a physical wire connecting your speaker to your computer or your speaker to your smartphone. With Bluetooth, an internet connection is not required. So it's similar to Wi-Fi in the sense that it's wireless technology, but Bluetooth has nothing to do with the internet. In this example, I've got a wireless speaker. With that wireless speaker, I can connect my tablet, my laptop, my smartphone to this wireless speaker, and I can move these devices around. I can move my wireless speaker around my home, depending on which room I want to listen in. This happens to be the Bluetooth wireless speaker that I own. The company who makes it is called UE Boom, and it comes in different sizes, different shapes, different colors. But this is the one that I carry with me in my bag when I teach and I travel. So you've got your typical Bluetooth wireless speaker, but it also comes in formats of headphones and also what's referred to as earbuds that are now wireless. And with that, I'm going to wrap it up. Thank you so much for joining me today. For more information on group or private in-home instruction, please visit my website, DanielTeaches.com,
or you can call me at 585-902-8450 or email me at daniel@danielteaches.com.